been good. It's been exciting. And it's springtime. Are you guys excited about springtime? The trees are budding. They're starting to, everything's starting to get green. I don't know. Maybe some of you have thought about, you thoughts about snow, you just got to put it aside. It's not going to happen. But I noticed, and I'm not sure, completely sure, but did Mark sing for the first time on the platform? Well, she did before, I guess, but he did a good job. Miss Bradley, I've seen you up here singing. Good job. Not often, but as a group, I'm sure she did come with that. It's a blessing. Blessing to see all the ladies at the retreat. I heard they had a wonderful time. And I was motivated to hear the testimonies, too. Dennis Miller also shared with me this morning that his wife's surgery was very successful. They had replaced the valve or repaired it, and then did one bypass, and she's going to progress, and then probably, he said she'll probably be home. She's in Atlanta, but she'll probably be home soon. It would be a help to him. Financially, he needs help. He's going back and forth Atlanta every day. So this morning after the service, we're going to have a special offering for Dennis. The ushers will stand in the back of the auditorium, and as you're leaving, would you be willing to help provide gas or food and provision for him and his wife as they're going through this situation? So glad to be here. So glad to see Hope and DJ.
Hi.
You guys stand. Hope and DJ. This is Hope's new husband, guys. This is Hope's new husband. Introduce your husband. Introduce your husband, Daryl. His name is Daryl. DJ is what we call him, his nickname. Good to see you, DJ. Good to have you. And then you have a friend with you? Meet your friend. What is her name? Yasmin. Okay, Yasmin from Ohio. Is your sign name? Good to have you here, Yasmin, with us. Okay. Wow, that's great. It's good. This morning, I thank the Lord for this church. I'm thankful for this church. And the reason I'm so thankful for this church really is a missions-minded church. We have a missions-minded church. We have a people in our church that give and support missions, missionaries. We support 36 missionaries. We get excited about it. We look forward to adding 4 new missionaries this spring. You want to be a part of this mission, these missions projects. And when you see the flags and what they represent, these different countries that they represent, oftentimes you and I, we have to ask ourselves, will we pray? And I'm asking this morning, will you pray as we get ready for April Missions Conference? March 13th, and then the 22nd, or the 20th, and then April 3rd. We have several Sundays that we are going to focus on the Missions Conference and get ready for the Missions Conference. March 27th is Easter. Of course, we'll take a break on that day and focus on the resurrection. But I wanted to let you know this morning my heart. I love to hear missionaries and their stories. I love when God allows us to see their work and take a step into their lives and see their field and their work and what they're doing there. And I believe it's a tremendous blessing to us. So I'm praying that you get involved. Get involved with Faith Promise. I want to encourage you this morning. Read 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and 9 as it talks to us about Faith Promise. And some of us say, how can I get involved? Well, first of all, we have to know that we're saved. That's the first step. I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, and then I've obeyed the Lord, taken the step of baptism, and then I begin seeking my heart and making sure that my heart is willing to do what He wants me to do so that I can see Him bless. He commands us to take on responsibilities. He commands us in the area of the tithe, but Faith Promise is different. And a lot of us don't understand Faith Promise and what it truly means. It's meeting the needs of missions works through added support. And so this morning I want to show you from the scriptures, I want to a little bit explain to you about the missions work, missionaries work. I have 3 missionaries that I'm going to just present to you this morning. If you don't mind turning on the platform lights, And so I want you to know, Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20, of course, teaches us that we're to go to all nations and teach and baptize and disciple. We know that, right? We understand salvation and then the progression we make, and then we get involved with the spreading of the gospel. So this morning, you've seen the letter from Australia. You understand. Robert, Lisa, Gunter, missionaries to Australia. They're in Australia. They're doing the work of helping and reaching out to deaf people with the good news there to track distribution. And then you read about Narda. Narda's at a deaf school in Jamaica, involved in seeing kids come to know the Lord through that school. So the last one you saw is Africa. Jimmy and Julie Sakalis, they're going to be with us during the missions conference in April. And my heart is touched. Jimmy himself is deaf, and he went to Africa, and he's discipled. It said he was discipling five men. So I want you to get an understanding of the picture. Those five men, he's discipling, and then when those five men become leaders, they'll become involved in spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ in Africa. They'll be a part of it. So I want you to think about that, and I want you to understand. You also can become a part of this. But you've got to seek your heart. You've got to be a member of the church. You join the church, you become a member, and as you become a member, you participate in our faith promise program. We want to see God using our missionaries, the lives of our missionaries. So this morning, I'm going to ask, are you motivated? Are you motivated in the area of faith promise? As we near our missions conference, we're going to have four families here. Rusty and Cassie are going to come. Jonathan and Amy are going to come. We're going to talk about supporting them. Those people that we've sent out. But our faith promise has shrunk a little bit. So if it shrinks, we cannot take on these new people. So I'm asking you to seek your heart. Are you willing? Are you willing? In your heart, are you willing? Do you say, well, I know a lot of our people struggle financially, but when you come to the place that you're willing, God blesses. God provides needs. And so the first thing we want to look at, or what we want to look at this morning, is the power of motivity, or being motivated. First, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 through 8, Paul is penning this here, and Paul's writing to the church at Corinth. Paul's encouraging the church at Corinth. He's encouraging them, the Corinthian people. And the Corinthian people that he's writing to, they have money. It was a business center. It was a trade center. It was a place where the people were financially stable. Paul's traveled throughout many areas. When he comes to this area, he realizes what they have. And so Timothy goes back after Paul's there and encourages the church at Corinth. Titus is a help. He assists Paul and helps Paul as he travels and teaches. And so God is sending Titus, and he's going to go and be a help. And he gathers the funds that are given to Paul, and then he distributes those to the missionaries that are working along with Paul, supporting the missionaries, supporting the works there, and supporting the spreading of the gospel. So it started here. And the church in Corinth, the people here were not givers. They were not givers as some other churches were. They were not motivated. They didn't have the vision. Now the church of Macedonia, in this specific area of that, there were three churches in Macedonia. Lost my glasses. I'm sorry, these are my wife's. Okay. The church at Philippi was one of the churches. The church at Thessalonica was one of the churches. And the church there at Berea. Okay, they were Macedonian churches. I'm a little bit embarrassed. I'm sorry. That kind of caught me off guard here. Lost my glasses. I have glasses all over the place. I lay them everywhere. And so I always think I have a pair and take advantage of that. All right, so those three churches of Macedonia, in those three cities, the city of Philippi, the city of Thessalonica, Berean church there. Those three were considered the Macedonian churches, and these people live in poverty. This is where the Roman Empire had taken over and taken, and the soldiers are, you know, they destroyed a lot of the buildings and things, and so the economy is terrible in these areas. But there were churches in these specific areas, and these people had hearts, good hearts. Paul is so impressed with these people. He's like, wow. And Titus reports, Paul, you can't believe the way these people give with willing hearts. So Paul is writing a letter of encouragement to the church at Corinth, the Corinthian people, encouraging them to give. He said, these people in Macedonia are giving through hard times and helping works, missions works. We need to work from the church of Macedonia. We need to take note of this church and give as they did. And I know, verse 1 through 8, I'm going to read that for you. Moreover, brethren, we do wit of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. Verse 2, how that in a great trial of affliction, suffering, trouble, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded unto the riches of liberality. For to their power, verse 3, for to their power I bear record, yea, and beyond their power. It's talking about their ability. They have proven through their ability, beyond their power, they were willing of themselves. So he's talking about their ability here. He's saying their ability, because of the power of God, they were able to do this for the Lord. And so this morning, you all have jobs. We all have homes. We have places where we live. We have food on our tables. We have cars. You have a car, don't you? Maybe you have a car. Most of you have a car. You have things that are necessities, clothing and all those things. You can walk throughout your house and see the necessities. But at the same time, missionaries have those needs too. Our missionaries have needs. They need our help because they're out there proclaiming the gospel. And they're doing a job that's very important for us. And so we want to be a help to them. Let me give an example to you. You can afford McDonald's. McDonald's, a quarter pounder with cheese and a french fry with a Coke is probably $6 now in America. Here, $6 in America. So how much is it? Megan, where's McDonald's? How much is it, Megan? Megan said $5.59. Megan's mom spot. She works at McDonald's. $5.59. Okay, Megan. So it's $5.59. And some of you, you'll go to Wendy's and you'll eat at Arby's and you'll stop at KFC and you eat at restaurants. And I know. Maybe you only do it once a week. But I know you can't hide the fact that you eat at restaurants. You do it. You can go out and eat. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's enjoyment. We try to make some enjoyment in our life every week. But probably $20 a month, you know, goes towards meals at restaurants if you kind of bring that together for the month. I'm just trying to challenge you to think about the $20 a month that you spend and then what you can give to missions. There's times when we just have to sacrifice. There's times when we can say we can be a help in the work. We can be a blessing to missionaries. And so I want to challenge you in your life, everything we do, the first thing that we have to do in being motivated is to thank God for our salvation. We're so thankful. Lord, we're thankful for what you've done for us. We're thankful that you provided, the job you provided, what you've given to me. I thank you, Lord, for what you've done. And then as a result of being thankful, we give to him and his work. And part of that's faith promise. Look at Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. And this is talking about our lives. This applies to our lives. It says, but seek. And this is talking about with your hearts. With your hearts. I want a burden. I want a vision. I want to know about these missionaries. I want to make them a part of their lives and the salvations that they're involved in over there and what they're doing. Just as you saw in Australia on the letter today. This is talking about our hearts, our finances, our clothes, and all the necessities that we have. They're not ours anyway, they're his. How many of us believe that? Our home is not ours. It's his. We give, you know, we come to the place that we give everything to the Lord. You provided the job and everything, the clothing and everything. I'm going to give it to you, Lord, because it belongs to you, and you do that, and I'm not going to preach on tithe this morning. But the tithe of the Lord has commanded that. He's commanded all of us that know him. We have that responsibility. The Bible says that. Malachi chapter 3 explains the tithe goes into the storehouse. And the tithe is for the local church, for the bills, for the lights, for the electric, for the expenditures that we have, for the mortgage, for the water, for all those things. That's natural. We know about that. We give the tithe. We keep our church going through our tithe. At the same time, God blesses us when we give the tithe, but then faith promises a willingness. It's a willingness. And God says, are you willing? Are you willing to get involved in investing in the lives of missionaries and investing in the lives of others? And so look what it says. It says, first of all, about grace giving. Grace giving, the grace of Macedonia. And we know this in the scripture there, in the portion of scripture where we were in verse 1 and 2. Verse 2 is what I'm going to focus on for the PowerPoint. Verse 2. Look what it says. How that in a great trial of affliction. And I want to focus on that word affliction. I kind of try to analyze that a little bit. I think we don't understand when we just pass through the scripture. But the people were really suffering at this time. Paul had traveled. He had traveled two or three times throughout this area. And, Paul had affliction in his life. I mean, they tried to kill him. They tried to kill Timothy just because they were spreading the gospel, giving out the good news. And so the Jewish people at this time had such a hatred towards those that were spreading the gospel. But Paul, he goes through these trials and these afflictions, and he suffers through them, and he struggles through them. At the same time, these people in Macedonia, they're going through those same types of things, same types of struggles. They're trying to budget. They don't have no food. They're remaining faithful to church no matter what circumstance we have. No matter if we have enough bread at home, no matter if we have enough food at home, no matter if we don't have enough money, that's okay because God's first in our lives. And we've made him first. And they would say, Lord, we love you. You have been good to us. We have seen the grace that you have given in our lives, and that you saved us. You've allowed us a church, a place to worship. And so as a thankfulness, Lord, it will happen. We're going through hard times, we're testing. But Lord, we're going to step out by faith. We're going to give this to you. And Paul said, oh my, thank you. Because of the help you've been in my ministry, I'm able to reach out to people because of what you gave. And then what does it have? What does it say next? And the abundance of their joy. And see that conflict. They were in suffering, but then it said they were overflowing. There was abundance of joy. How could that be? Over here, they're going through struggles, and they're going through hard times, and it was a time when you really would understand that they had no joy, but they had joy. These people had joy because they were able to give liberally. They were able to give. The people of Macedonia were poor, they went through struggles, and they said, boy, God's going to do that. So because of his goodness, we're going to step out on faith, and we are going to give, and Titus is gathering. He would gather the funds and visit the churches and bring them and distribute them to the missionaries and take care of Paul's needs. Paul's also, while he's preaching, he's being a tent maker and he's working and he's earning money also for his mission work. And they helped other churches through that. And again, Paul is being blessed and his ministry is being blessed and the gospel is being spread because of this group of people over here who, in the midst of their affliction, stepped out and gave. We're blessing the people. They're suffering, but they said, boy, this is joyful. This causes joy. And God provided for those people as a result. Let me tell you, the peace of God and joy of God is something that you cannot trade for anything in this world. The joy that God gives us cannot be traded for anything in this world. Anything this world gives you cannot replace the joy of God. It only comes through Christ. Joy comes through Christ. The joy of Christ that he gives us brings satisfaction for needs. And so these people are getting joy. They're giving the joy in their heart in the midst. And the reason they were joyful was because God is blessing them. He's giving them joy. How many of us have that joy? You can have that. You have a job. You have a home. You thank God for what He's given you, the food He's given you, and you thank, and you're thankful for those things, and it brings you joy and knowing. But then we miss because we have to say, are we going to be part of the joy that's given as we give to missions? When you give to missionaries and begin supplying, there's a joy that comes. I mean, during troubled times and struggles, you say, man, bless. Struggles are good for us because they bring trust. And they help us to trust and rely on God. And then the second thing here, the growth. The grace that was pictured at Macedonia to the growth of the Macedonians. I mean, they're growing. They're growing in their motivation. And, of course, the power of motivation is what we're talking about. And we're going to talk about the power of their ability, too. There was power shown through their ability. You know, I was looking at those portions of scriptures and the word willingness. I think that's in verse 3. It says, for to their power, I bear record, yea, and beyond their power, they were willing of themselves. Willing of themselves. And then look at verse 5. Verse 5 of that chapter. Okay? Verse 5, it says, but first gave their own selves to the Lord. That was first. So you and I, when we give our lives to the Lord, and we give to Him what He wants. That's what He wants. He wants us to give of ourselves. So we give of ourselves first. It says, but first gave of themselves. And again, I'm going to repeat this. I'm going to ask you a question. Are you willing? Are you willing? So first, you come to the belief in Jesus Christ, you accept Him as your Savior, then you obey the Lord to the place that you're baptized, you become obedient, you become right, and you give your life completely to the Lord, saying, it's not mine, it's yours. I'm willing to do, Lord, whatever you want me to do. I'm willing to serve you, Lord, and however you want me to serve. There's a willingness there, and along with that willingness, that means if we're not giving any faith promise, and we're not tithing, something's wrong in our lives. There's something preventing that willingness in our lives. If you're not willing, there may be sin preventing that. There may be debts. There may be addictions. And you could go down a long list of things that prevent us from giving. I can't give because of this. I can't give because of this. And really, the problem comes. We are just not putting Him first, seeking Him first, His kingdom of God. Oh, we buy iPads. We buy all kinds of TVs. We buy cars. And we forsake being willing to give to God. And there's things that are preventing us from giving. There's no motivation. But these people in Macedonia were willing. Now, there's nothing wrong with you buying a car and buying those things I talked about. I'm talking about, are you willing to give to God also? Let me tell you a true story. I was traveling throughout Florida, and I was in Florida, and I went for a meeting, and I was preaching in a meeting in Florida. And when I preached, I finished, and somebody met me and said, I don't tithe. I don't give to my church. And they came to me. I didn't approach them. They said, I don't give tithe. I don't give to the Lord. Well, the person was a Christian, and he said, I know I should be, but I haven't been tithing. I am not doing that. I really feel like I don't need to, and that's the attitude I've had. And I don't give to missions. Oh, yeah, I had a boat. Big boat. He bought a big boat, and he loved to fish. You know, the ocean's there. And all those deep sea fishing and all these rods. And there's a lot of equipment that goes when you get into those things. So he shared with me that he had not been tithing. He came to me and he told me that one day he was fishing. And he got really sick. I mean, really. And after he got better, he got the bill and it was $15,000. And he had to pay the doctor bill. He had to pay the bill. So he gets this $15,000 bill and he looks at that boat parked in his yard and he thought, oh, I can't pay this bill. And he said, Lord, $15,000 I think is about what I owe you. And I'm in the hospital now. I haven't been tithing. He told God he couldn't pay the bill, and God said, we haven't been given to me either. You know, you want to go to the Lord about your bills, because you don't give to the Lord, but that's kind of hypocrisy. And so he's like, I haven't been given to the Lord. I feel so convicted, and now I have this bill, and I can't go to the Lord about this bill. And so he said, Lord, forgive me. I haven't given to you as I should. So I'm going to sell my boat. So he sold the boat. Got $18,000. Got the $18,000 and had $3,000 left, and he paid his $15,000 hospital bill, and he said, Lord, I'm sorry. I need to be faithful to you. I'm repenting, I'm coming back to you in this area, and I will give to you. And God said, come on, come on. So he began tithing and giving to the Lord, but he missed his boat. Well, he missed it. He was a fisherman. He loved fishing. He said, Lord, can I fish? And the Lord said, sure, you can. My boat, but make sure you're giving. And so he came to the time where he was able to tithe and give to the Lord, and then he was able to save money for that boat, because he didn't forget the lesson he learned. And he put aside that money, and he gave a big promise, and a neighbor right next door wanted to sell a boat, almost exactly like his boat. And he didn't jump into it. He said, God, can I buy that boat? I really like that boat. And the Lord, you've given to me. Have you given to me yet? Are you given permission? Go ahead and buy the boat. Buy the boat. If you have the money, buy the boat. Guess what? He went to his neighbors and he said, that's exactly the boat. Just a little bit smaller than my boat, almost exactly. How much are you going to sell that for? And the neighbor said, I'm going to give $5,000. $5,000? So he had $5,000. He was able to pay cash for that boat. Tow it over to his driveway, put it in his driveway, and own it. A little bit older, it's okay. He didn't have to miss fishing. You know, he said, I'm a person, and I'll be honest with you, Bridget, I can't live without fishing, and that's fine. He loved fishing. Florida people are crazy. A lot of them are crazy about deep sea fishing. There are boats in every yard when you go to Florida. And that's fine. That's good, that's fine. But understand the concept of what we're talking about. How important it is for you to get this principle in your life of management in the area of finances, stewardship. Where Chris talks about being a good steward, having good management, managing that, knowing the budget, budgeting your money, tithing. A lot of people say, wow, God bless my finances. God, I want you to bless the missionaries and let me be a part of that. And sometimes you really don't understand. We had four people move, and we sent four people out. They were big, big promise givers. Now, I don't know how much they gave, but I know they gave big. We average in our area of faith promise about $4,500 a month is what we have. Those four families moved. We probably lost about $1,000 a month. Pastor, you praise the Lord for that? Oh, I still praise the Lord. We sent them out. Praise the Lord. We've got to still praise the Lord for that, but I'm challenging you now to pray and be willingly involved in faith promise giving. You're going to struggle. But give, and God bless us. How exciting it is that we're able to be involved as a church in the lives of missionaries and see these mission projects grow. And so with me, you understand that Titus, he came to the church of Macedonia. Macedonia had been taught. He gathers the funds, the giving from the Macedonian church. He brings it, I guess by horseback, or didn't have planes, however, they didn't text. He didn't text and say how much he got. Horseback, camel, whatever. He gets there and he tells Paul, I'm so excited to present this to you. Paul said, who gave this? The church of Macedonia gave. Why? And the church at Macedonia had given more than the church at Corinth. Paul's heart is touched. What does he do? He challenges the church, the Corinthians people. He motivates those people to give what they could give out of willingness. God was blessed. Last thing was the gathering, and I talked to you about the gathering of it. Gathering of Macedonia, what they brought in. I wonder what we're going to gather as a result of your faith this year. I'm here to tell you that we presented you with these two little items, treasure chests, and a lot of us have forgotten about them and put them somewhere in the house. My wife and I, we've had fun. I'm not bragging, but we've done our fourth. We love sticking quarters in. It's just fun. Put quarters in these things, and we like to fill them up. We fill them up together and stick the quarters in here, and you know, when you get to all this change that you don't need, you can stick them in these little things. And then this treasure chest, you place funds within that. You put the funds within that, and we also have money bags. We've asked you to give $50 to $100 before the missions conference. And a lot of you say, what's that for? Why do we have to do that? Why do we have to do that? We have more missionaries coming to be with us. Dr. Sis, Dr. Don Sis, he's been serving for 15 years as going to be our main speaker. And we've got to take in these funds, and then we've got to provide the needs that week for our missionaries. We have a responsibility to be a blessing to them while they're here. So we're bringing in four missionaries that mean a great deal to us, that are working hard on the field, that are a blessing and going to be a tremendous blessing to us. They're at home calling and trying to get meetings in Keene and Snowy with their two children, being sick in the last few weeks, stuck in Virginia in a hotel for several days. It's not an enjoyable thing that they're going through, trying to raise the support. Snowy's been sick, Keene's been sick. They've been in hotels. They've been trying to take care of things on the road in order to raise their support, but they're blessed and serving in joy, raising their support on reputation. And we're going to be a part. You know, we're kind of in our comfort zone here. Let's be a part of this. Let's be a blessing. Titus, again, is mentioned in verse 6, where they talk in verse 6 about Titus, inasmuch as we desire Titus that as he had begun, so he would also finish in you the same grace also. Verse 7, therefore, as ye abound in everything, in faith and utterance and knowledge and in all diligence and in your love to us, see that you abound in this grace also. Verse 8, I speak not by commandment, but by occasion. Excitement of the forwardness of others. And to prove the sincerity in your love. Before I close this morning, I kind of sought out what it means about faith, utterance, knowledge, and those things. The seriousness of our mind, the sincerity of our mind. The sincerity of our mind brings a love. So what do you love? Ask yourself, what do I love? TV? Car? What things are you putting before Him? Kind of weigh that this morning. Be honest. I mean, just bring it to mind. I love Christ. You say, I love Christ. I love God. And so I'm going to do to be involved with Life City Missionaries because I love. It's really, it says not my commandment here. It's kind of, it's up to you and your willingness. So honestly, within your mind today, say, what do I love? Look at your heart. Where's my love? Is my love giving? Is my love helping? Our Father, thank you, Lord, for your word. Help us, Lord, to understand the people of Macedonia and how they gave. They gave more than their ability for your power. Help us to be willing to do that. They were willing. It was hard. They were struggling. they were willing to give to you, Lord, to support your missions, your work. Lord, we take these scriptures and apply them to us this morning. We pray that you'll speak to our hearts this morning, that first, we know that we're saved. Second, we know that we're obedient yet to you, and then going on to serve you through this way, that we're obeying you in the area of tithe and getting involved in the willingness of faith promise in your work. The joy. Giving the joy. Help us to get the picture to ourselves within this picture. Help us to realize how you bless and meet needs. In Jesus' name.